We only have done flagship smartphone chip reviews before, but I know a lot of you guys are looking forward to mid-tier just because of the price tag. Honestly, I think the mid-tier was kind of chaotic in the past because a lot of those Qualcomm 7 series chips, they're just lacking too much behind the 8 series flagships. I'm talking about the 730G, 765G, or 778G. Their CPU and GPU are significantly behind, not to mention the huge difference in their peripherals. Even if you're not into gaming, their ISPs and AI capabilities will make their camera look less impressive. I mean, for most people, they're fine, they're decent enough, but if I can buy an old flagship at the same price, I just won't consider those 7 series products. And last year's 7 Gen 1 fabricated by Samsung? Well, that's just a joke. You know what's more oops for them? MediaTek is actually catching up very fast, as we mentioned before. Their Dimensity 8100 really delivers a lot. Apparently, Qualcomm knows all those issues, and somehow in this year, they decided to make some changes to the humble 7 series. Right now, what I'm holding here is an engineering sample from Qualcomm. It's the QRD, Qualcomm Reference Design. And inside this little machine here, we have the latest Snapdragon 7 Plus Gen 2. Yes, it's a new generation and a plus sign. You got them both in the name. So how excited is that, right? And I gotta tell you, this is not an ordinary upgrade. This is something bigger. This might be the best 7 series chip in a very long time. So what exactly is this 7 Plus Gen 2? Well, let's talk about it today. But before we jump into anything, have you ever wondered how we really learn those complicated technical stuff? Well, I mean, you probably have to learn a few things about math or computer science. They're just great topics and very interesting to learn with our sponsor, Brilliant.org. Brilliant has thousands of lessons from basic and advanced math to AI, neural networks, data science, and more, with new lessons added monthly. For example, we wrote some Python programs to automatically pick our data and make the chart for us, so it really makes our job much easier. Where in Brilliant, you can learn Python coding easily with zero prerequisites. This interactive Python course will go from the basic console, logic, and all the way to making graphs, like what we did in our reviews. I really recommend you to grab some coding skills on Brilliant. It can really help you a lot. So, ready to level up your skills? Use our link brilliant.org/geekone and try everything Brilliant has to offer for free for a full 30 days. And for a limited time, the first 200 people use our link will get a 20% off their annual premium subscription. So don't wait, start learning with Brilliant today. All right, let's get back to our Snapdragon 7 Plus Gen 2. First things first, the spec looks pretty impressive. It's made using TSMC's 4-nanometer process, and the CPU features one Cortex X2 core, three A710 core, and four A510 core. That means the CPU is pretty much identical to the Snapdragon 8 Plus. Wow, finally the 7 series gets a true prime core. But when it comes to the clock speed, it's not as aggressive as the 8 Plus. The clock speed for each core are actually a bit lower. And just like the 8 Plus, the 7 Plus Gen 2 offers 6 megabytes of level 3 cache, although it shrinks the SLC system level cache into half. It looks like Qualcomm just took the 8 Plus, cut it down a little bit on spec, and make a 7. So is this like a lighter version of 8 Plus? Well, it does seem a bit similar. In fact, it might actually be the same chip. Let's look at the other parts, like the GPU. The 7 Plus Gen 2 uses an Adreno 725 GPU, which might sound different from the Adreno 730 on the 8 Plus, but guess what? They're actually the same thing with identical core sizes. So it's all about clock speed. The 8 Plus GPU can reach a very high clock speed of 900 MHz, while the 7 Plus Gen 2 is limited to a max of 580 MHz. Man, that's quite harsh for a GPU underclocking. It feels like we are getting back to these Snapdragon 865 days, but look at the bright side, clock speed isn't everything. With essentially the same core count and TSMC 4-nanometer process, I'm pretty optimistic about the power efficiency of this GPU. The other peripherals of the 7 Plus Gen 2 are quite interesting as well. For example, it now supports triple 18-bit ISPs as the 8 Plus, meaning the 7 series can finally be used in camera-focused phones. In terms of AI, it's also using a configuration similar to the A+. We ran some MLPerf benchmarks, and while the 7 Plus Gen 2 lags behind A+, in some areas, it's close in others. The only significant difference between 7 Plus Gen 2 and A+ might be in the modem. The 7 Plus Gen 2 is equipped with a X62 5G modem, offering a lower maximum download bandwidth than the A+. However, the 7 Plus Gen 2 still supports Wi-Fi 6E with pretty decent speed, so just like its more powerful sibling. To me, it feels like the 7 Plus Gen 2 might have actually come from the same piece of silicon as the A+. Just imagine maybe they took the best part with the best quality for the A+, and used the surrounding area for the 7 Plus Gen 2. Ha, just kidding, huh? But seriously, they're really likely sharing the same origin. With the specs from the 8 series, I'm really excited to see what kind of performance it can deliver. So let's dive in and run some Geekbench 5 to see how the 7 Plus Gen 2 CPU performs. Compared to the previous 7 Gen 1, there is a massive 49% increase in single core and a 47% increase in multi-core performance. Truly an epic upgrade. In comparison to the competing Dimensity 8200, the 7 Plus Gen 2 with its larger core has an absolute advantage in single core performance, while the multi-core scores are pretty close between the two. But peak performance alone isn't enough. Here at GeekerOne, the power efficiency curves are our main course. This is where 7 Plus Gen 2 is located, and it seems to be slightly lower to the A+ in terms of efficiency, so the power consumption stays a little bit higher at the same performance. I don't know, maybe it's the quality of the silicon, or maybe it's just because we're testing engineering samples here, so you have to take it with a grain of salt. But the thing is, A+ itself isn't famous for its power efficiency, mainly because the A710 cores aren't really the best choices, so it's no surprise the 7 Plus Gen 2 is far from taking the efficiency crown. It's comparable with the Dimensity 9000, but not really close to the Dimensity 8200. However, compared to the previous 7 Gen 1, its power efficiency has already taken a huge step. Especially in mid to high clock speed, it's not even in the same league, let's say. So at least you know TSMC is doing the proper work here. And now let's take a look at the GPU efficiency. As I mentioned before, this Adreno 725 GPU is basically the same as the 730, but drastically lowering down the clock speed. This little buddy here does drop behind A+ a lot, but still delivers a healthy amount of performance. At its peak, it's actually more than twice as powerful as the previous 7 Gen 1. Well, back then, the 7 Gen 1's GPU wasn't actually too lame, using a downclocked A65's GPU. But the Adreno 600's architecture was a bit outdated as of today's standard, since our GPUs have made huge progress in the past couple of few years. And power efficiency-wise, you guessed it, it's slightly less impressive than the A+ on the peak. But luckily for lower clock speed, it's almost identical to A+. To be honest, this GPU efficiency is not bad at all for a mid-tier contender. It can easily outperform the 8200 and even the MediaTek 9000 in terms of efficiency, not to mention its predecessor. Well, the 7 Plus Gen 2 is pretty much as we expected, a cost-down version of an old flagship with the right person manufacturing it. So the question is, can it deliver the performance in games? We tested Genshin Impact to find the answer, and it turns out to be pretty decent. During the first 11 minutes of the running, the frame rate stays around 56 FPS. The prime and performance core are running at 2.4 GHz, and the power consumption reaches 6.8 watt. So the gaming experience is actually quite solid on this chip. And while the power efficiency isn't quite on par with the 8 Plus machine, it's still somehow acceptable. However, this solid performance is not sustainable for a long time, at least on this QRD sample here. And after 30 minutes, it averages at about 52 FPS while consuming 6.3 watts of power. Nevertheless, this new chip is still significantly more powerful than the previous 7 series. I mean, we are running the game on a very high preset, which is super demanding. And running this game on the previous 7 Gen 1 is basically a disaster, with the frame rate drops below 25. In comparison, the 7 Plus Gen 2 just handles it smoothly. And if you compare it to the 8200 from MediaTek, the main competitor, it still leads quite a margin. And I have to say, even Qualcomm Qualcomm is cutting every corner possible, it is still a decent gaming experience for a flagship killer. So today we just had a quick preview of the new Snapdragon 7 Plus Gen 2. In my opinion, it might not have the best power efficiency, but it really suits those budget gaming phones, or mid-tier sub-flagships. It won't have too much difference comparing to the 8 Plus, maybe at $300 to $400, this is going to be some true bang for the buck. And I'm looking forward to see the potential of the upcoming retail phones. So what do you guys think about this new chip? Let me know in the comment section below, and if you found this video helpful, don't forget to like, subscribe to our channel, and this is GeekerOne, catch you guys next time.